dos. Uno. Uno. Yay. Ei vielä. Can you zoom here? Can you zoom to me?
Test, test, 1, 2, 1, 2. We're good.
Hey, everyone. And the cameraman zoomed it off. Hello, everyone. welcome to day two. Today we have 19 games to offer for you. We start with The Legend of Zelda and into Dark Souls.
Oh, and hello, 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 hello.
Yay, they work. And there's going to be a few special things, like in Max Payne 2, we are going to have one developer here, Sami Vanhatalo, yeah, to talk with us, do the commentary when they got to play it. And we're going to now start with Majora's Mask by VPP, and Slucky is doing the commentating, so give these guys a big hand, and hopefully you enjoy the day too. Thank you.
All right, we're ready. All right. Let's go. 3, 2, 1, go. Hello and good morning, everyone. Welcome to the second day of Finruns or Speed Games United. I'm VPP, and next to me is Luffy.
Hello.
I'm going to be doing Majora's Mask Any Percent. And I'm going to be playing on the Japanese version. And usually a lot of the older games are played on the Japanese version because of the faster text. But in Majora's Mask, there's actually a few special properties that the Japanese version has. We're going to get into those later in the game when they matter. So, here we have the intro sequence. This game is pretty notorious for its long intro. Hopefully this won't turn into a first cycle stream.
How many buttons do you mash to in advanced dialogue?
You can mash three different buttons. You can mash A, B, and C up to advance text. I usually do just A and B, though. Mashing the C button, or C up button with the GameCube controller is kind of
a bit difficult.
Yeah. And yeah, this is the Wii U version, or VVC version of the game. The versions are pretty similar on N64 and VVC, but the VVC version lags a little less and it has faster loading zones, so it ends up being the fastest version to run this game. Interesting thing is that a Wii U VC version of this game came out some time ago, and it actually turned out to be slower. It loads slower than the Wii version.
For the same reasons, like loading zones on the...
Yeah, the loading zones are slower on the Wii U version. Interestingly.
Thank you.
All right, so now we're getting control, and you can see here that I'm gonna walk backwards towards where I need to go, and this is actually a little bit faster than just walking straight. Now I'm gonna roll, which is also a little bit faster than just walking straight. As human, backwalking is the fastest way to travel without doing any glitches, but the thing is about the movement in this game that it only benefits you if you try to or want to walk in a straight line. If you have to turn a lot, then rolling is usually the best way to move around.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't there like an acceleration with backwalking? So if it's a short distance, it's better to roll?
Yeah, that too. The distance where a backwalk is useful is about the equivalent of 5 rolls, if I remember right. So shorter distances than 5 rolls, they are worth to just roll. So yeah, up to this point, the run's been fairly normal to normal, or fairly similar to normal gameplay. But there's the first trick in the run coming up soon. The first time I enter Clock Tower, there will be a cutscene trigger that activates once I pass the trigger on the stairs. And what I can do, I can skip it by a technique called boss buffering. And what it does is whenever the game wants to play a cutscene, it needs 2 frames for it to activate. But if I could use a method called pause buffering, which is pausing and unpausing my game frame by frame, it doesn't actually allow the cutscene to activate since it needs 2 frames. That way I can delay the cutscene trigger and hopefully proceed through the Clock Town doors without even watching the cutscene. Come on now. Releasing A too early. Okay, nice. getting that cutscene skip saves about 40 seconds. Usually in speedrun attempts, if you miss that, it's an instant reset. It's a quite long cutscene that we skipped.
What's
and the now, sorry. And now we're off to Clocktown, and this segment of the run is something we call first cycle. And our objectives are to get the Ocarina and get some magic and go see Skull Kid. So what are we gonna do, since we cannot enter the clock tower without it being the midnight of the third day? We're gonna first off advance time as much as we can. And the fastest way to do that is to visit Grandma in the Stockpot Inn. So here's Grandma, she's gonna tell us some stories. The bottom option will take you straight a day forward. But it's still daytime, so I want to next go to the trading post, where there's Scarecrow that has the same kind of thing. I can use that to advance to the night of the final day.
So with Deku Link, your spinning move and back walking is pretty much the same.
Yeah, the movement mechanics are mostly the same. Spinning is sort of equivalent to rolling as human, and back walking is the fastest way to travel. So now we're on the night of the final day, and we have to wait until midnight and collect some stuff in between. So what I'm gonna do next, I'm gonna head to West Clocktown to collect the stray fairy that I need to return to the fairy fountain to get magic. And next off, I'm gonna head to Terminal Field. Although this guy is trying to block me, but if you just backwalk against him, you'll clip under him and you can exit Clocktown early. And here what I wanted to do is to collect some rupees for later use.
So what's the drop rate on the blue rupees?
I have no idea. I don't know exactly what the percentage is. But there's so many bushes that usually you get at least over 60 rupees, and getting 90 rupees, which is the maximum amount that benefits me, it's fairly common. So this is a fairly slow way of getting money, but since I have to wait until the midnight of the third day anyway, this is the only like feasible option for us. Since we don't have anything else to do, might as well use that time to collect some money.
So is this first cycle kind of like essentially an auto-scroller basically?
Yeah, basically, yeah. Okay, I got 90. That's good. And also, one thing I forgot to mention about the movement. If you have to quickly travel to a 90 degrees angle. Side hopping is a good way to do that. In a task setting, which is a tool-assisted speedrun where you can basically do everything perfectly, side hopping is the fastest way of traveling, but as a human, in real-time runs, it's not feasible to side hop anywhere. But if there's a 90-degree turn you need to make, it's a good option.
How fast is the task for this game?
It's kind of outdated, but I can't actually remember exactly. I think it's around 128 with the task timing, which differs a little bit from the RTA timing. It is done in 2011 or 2012, I think. But there's a new task in the making, actually, right now. A fellow named The Wayfaring Fox is currently making a new task for this game. And so yeah, you might be wondering, I was supposed to do the whole Bomber's Kid session to get the Moon Steer, but there's a really simple trick that you can do to skip all that. So what I did there is, I did sort of a forwards backflip by targeting a wall, backflipping, and targeting it, the same wall, right after it. So what that did, it actually cancels all my backwards momentum, and with that I can gain height, and I can grab onto ledges I wouldn't normally would be able to grab. So doing that, I skipped the whole Moonsteer sequence, and playing with the Bomber Kits.
Closest thing to traditional jumping.
Yeah. So we got the ocarina back, and now we can actually do stuff with it. But before that, there's a couple of more cutscenes.
You didn't want to hear the game audio, did you?
Yeah, that was kind of loud. I don't know if it got heard on the stream, but yeah. Some loud music going on.
I would assume it did.
Thank you. All right, so what happens next? We learned the Song of Time, and now we can go back in time. So I'm gonna play the Song of Time. And when the text box comes up to asking me to save the game, I'm gonna reset my console. And what that will do is it will skip a cutscene where Link has some sort of flashbacks. And that saves about a minute, I think.
So this is the start of the second cycle. How many cycles are in this run?
There are 5 cycles in this run. There's a trick later in the run that requires us to reset our game, so that's the sole reason for it. The old N% run used to be only 2 cycles, so you can beat the game in 3 in-game hours. In-game days, I mean. But it's just faster to use that many cycles. And about the structure of this run, this run is fairly short, but I still need to beat all of the 4 temples. But there's a number of sequence breaks involved in them. But there's no way to access the moon without beating all of the 4 temples, so you get to see all those. Yeah, this run has a really long intro before stuff starts to get interesting. But it's almost over. Bear with me.
Is that how you feel sometimes?
Yeah.
Going through the intro.
Alright, now we are back as human, and now we get to do stuff. First thing I'm gonna do is to collect some money to buy explosives from the Clock Tower Bomb Shop. And the fastest way to get 99 rupees is a 100 rupee chest here in East Clock Tower. Thank you. Here I'm gonna buy a bomb bag and 10 bomb shoes. And explosives in this game are really useful. You're gonna see in just a second. In West Blacktown, there's a so-called hidden owl, which is a prop to see the South Clocktown owl from West Clocktown, since there's a loading zone there. So, it's an actual working owl, and it has some special properties I'm gonna explain later. But to get there, I need to pass this loading zone. So, what I'm gonna do is that I'm gonna activate a glitch called Infinite Sword Glitch, and that has a property. Whenever I shield explosions in the air, Link will get stuck. So, if I keep doing that, I can gain height and hover around the loading zone. So there's the hidden owl, and this trick that I'm gonna do is something called ocarina diving. And while I play some double time mid-air and void out, it actually stores the text box of the song. So the next time I activate any text box, which is a text box right here, after this text box is over, it pops up. Nice selected no, actually, on that. Yeah. What was supposed to happen? I would have pressed yes, and it would have advanced into the night of the first day. That would have been a little bit faster than playing the song like this that I just did. But yeah, you have to move, like, sort of to the left, and you can sometimes accidentally select the wrong option. That's all right. So, I want to refill my bomb juice because I used up all of them. And now we're heading out of Clocktown. First thing I want to do is to go to the swamp, but I'm gonna take a little bit unusual route.
Is Deku Link the only one that can do the backwards clip past the guard?
Yeah, it is. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna head over to this grotto right here. Activate the infinite sword glitch again and do some more bomb hovering. And I want to get out of bounds in this grotto. And the way all the grottos and all the fairy fountains are done in this game, that all of them in the world exist on the same map. So what I can do, I can hover out of bounds. And I can travel from grotto to grotto. Oh. That's really bad. Well, I didn't make it into the grotto, so we're gonna have to do something else. Actually. Oh god, that's really bad. Well, what was supposed to happen, I would have went to another grotto, and I would have ended up in Deku Palace straight away, but since I missed it, we're gonna have to take another route in here. What I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna pull out my ocarina in front of this gossip stone, and what that'll do is enter a state called the Time Stop, which is basically an ocarina mode. Similar to like playing ocarina, but I can move in it. And what property that has is any cutscenes won't trigger. There's a cutscene trigger there, which I can just walk past by. So yeah. Since I failed a trick, I'm gonna take an alternative route here. Which is much more like the intended route. So here I want to pick up a Deku Stick and some Deku Nuts. And here's a trick, what I can do to travel really fast. If I roll into a bomb with my shield up, just as it explodes, I gain a lot of lot of speed. Same with here, except this is a little less speed that I wanted, but if you roll into an explosion while holding a certain or little direction of the control stick, Link will shuffle like that, and in that state, Link can preserve velocity gotten from explosives. So here I will get a bottle. I need a bottle in this run to collect the eggs in Great Bay Temple. Oh, not in Great Bay Temple, but in Great Bay area. From here, I want to proceed forward to Digipalace to get the Sonata of Awakening. But there's a big Octo in the way, and normally you're supposed to ride the boat and save save the witch to proceed through here. But what I can do, I can jump with a trick called long jump, where I gain a lot of velocity from the bomb here. And the big Octo will eat me, and I'm gonna drown as Deku. But after I respawn, there's some invisibility frames where I can move, so I can move past the...
I like that boost you. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And the big Octo on the other side just spits me out to the other side. So that skips the whole boat ride, and I don't have to visit the witch a second time. So here, I can utilize the hovering glitch to move through Digipalace really fast. I'm gonna hover over this platform.
That camera angle is so bad.
Yeah, it's sometimes hard to find the flower there. And with that, I can just enter straight to the chamber, monkey chamber. Alright, this song is one of the key items that we have to get in the speedrun. There's a couple songs related to the temples that you can skip, but this is one of them that cannot be skipped. As for now. So, next off, I want to get the Song of Soaring for fast traveling. And here's a little jump you can do to get there a little bit quicker. If you jump right at the end of that log, you will clip up. I remember when I talked about the special properties of the hidden owl in West Bucktown. Well, the thing is with that owl, it doesn't have a set position where it takes you when you play the Song of Soaring. That position or value can be modified. And how you modify that is quite simple. All you have to do is to, in the map screen, there's a different pointers where you can move your cursor to, and that actually manipulates that owl where it will take you.
So essentially locking that owl pretty much gives you access to all of them?
Yeah, pretty much. So what I'm going to do, in the map screen, I'm going to select Woodfall here, and then play it Song of Soaring. And where that will take me is Manta Village. Even though I never hit that owl, I've never visited there. Alright, next thing I want to do is grab some more bombs. And I want a few more bottles for... Oh, actually, I need to get rid of these. I want a few more bottles so I can complete the Pirate's Fortress and collect the 4 eggs at the same time. And how I can do that is hold a position called ESS position where Link will turn in place. What this state does is that some actions will be delayed. So what I do, I press the bottle button to activate the cutscene of Link emptying the fairy, but right after that, I'm gonna press the bomb chew button here. So what that'll do, it actually registers as writing the empty bottle over the bomb chew slot. That was a weird slip there. There's like a pixel with it, collision, I guess, on the bridge. That you can, go into that'll make Link slip, actually. And that's really bad in 100% runs, because you have to carry a powder keg there. And that pixel actually can make you drop the powder keg. And it can possibly explode. So there, I didn't select any pointer in the map screen before I played Song of Soaring, so it took me to the default place, which is Great Bay Coast. And the reason why I visited Mountain Village and Goro Village is that it gave me two more map pointers in the screen that'll be useful later on in the run. The Mountain Village one will take me to Woodfall, and the Goron Village one will take me to Stone Tower. Next up, I'm gonna head to Great Bay, and I'm gonna push Mikau to the shore to gain the Zora Mask, and there's a little trick that I can do with the fairy bottle here. If I empty it just as I finish pushing Mikau to the shore, I can actually empty the fairy while this cutscene is happening. This mask is another required item that you need to get in this run. Without it, you cannot access Great Bay Temple.
Special shout out to Enno, who plays the piano during these cutscenes.
No memes this time. We don't approve memes.
Bible thump.
All right, after this, I want to head to Pirate's Fortress to collect some eggs. A little super slide trick to go fast. And you can actually extend your super slide. Normally you cannot change the direction with a super slide. But if you hold the ESS position and let go of the super slide, you can preserve some of the speed. And that's a little bit faster than just backwalking. A little about Zora movement mechanics. Dolphin diving like this is a little bit faster than just swimming straight. But other than that, Zora mechanics and human mechanics are very alike. So I'm gonna head over this part of the map, and normally you're supposed to pound that switch as a Goron, but with the hovering glitch I can just skip all of that. Okay, so at the start of the run I talked about some of the special properties of the Japanese version of the game, and one of them is gonna come to use right over here in this next room. One property the Japanese version has that during nighttime the pirate's vision is reduced, so I can enter the main room right away and this pirate won't see me. So from here, drop a bomb, climb these barrels, and with the long jump glitch I can do a long jump to this tank without them seeing me. So from here I can shoot the Bihio Harvesticker and won't have to go to the upper level at all. If you would try this on the English version of the game, you'd get caught right as you open the door there. This is the one big reason why the Japanese version is much faster than the English version in this game.
What's with you in running games with enemies with bad vision?
I don't know. Well, luckily in MGS3 the guards aren't this bad, at least. So now we have the hookshot, and from here I'm gonna proceed to collect the free rest of the eggs. Rest free of the eggs. And for the second egg, I'm gonna do a little trick here to enter that loading zone straight ahead of me. And that's supposed to be the exit of the second egg room. But with short backflips, and if I start holding up right as I pass the ledge, I can actually grab it and just enter the exit there. So this skipped going through the other rooms and fighting a pirate before this room. For the third egg, I can do a very similar thing. If I jump this gap with a right angle and curve my jump to the right, I can go to the exit of this tank room, thus skipping another pirate fight. And for the fourth egg, I'm actually gonna take the intended route. You can skip this part fight too, but it requires some explosives and it's really not much faster. And there's a guard here, but you can pass her really easily. What happened there is I backflipped and side hop, and those are actually silent to the guards, so she didn't turn around to see me.
Bit ironic that the thing that causes you to yell is the one that's silent.
Alright, that was a pretty good fight. Oh, come on. Come on.
I was about to say, it seems like all the tank creatures are being nice.
There I did a similar trick that I used to make extra bottles out of items, but instead of shooting another item after pressing the bottle button, I pressed my B button. And what that does, it actually allows me to play a fake ocarina. So, I could soar over here straight from the tank. So now we're just gonna empty our bottles here. This side quest is also one required thing in this run. So far there's no way to get into Great Bay Temple without getting the song.
Does the loading zone for the turtle just not exist?
Yeah. I don't know the specifics, but you actually have to activate the turtle cutscene in order to advance to the temple. When you like ride the turtle, it just loads another map.
Hmm.
It doesn't like exist on the overworld. Same with the moon. The final cutscene when you play Off to Order actually takes you to the map of the moon. So, like, people have tried to hover to the moon to see if that would take you to the moon, but yeah, the moon is just a texture. It doesn't have any collision or any loading zones or anything.
Rest in peace, moon jump.
So here, normally you would maybe need the seahorse to point you to the right direction, but the route is the same every time, so you can just memorize the path. So yeah, this section is pretty normal, but over at the last egg, I can do the same trick I did when I was exiting the pirate's fortress. So, gonna catch the egg. Hold the SS position, and then fail it. Yeah, I could have soared away from there, but press the buttons too fast. That's quite rare to happen. Well, now I just have to exit the way normally, or exit this place normally. Alright, so we collected all the eggs and now we can learn the song. And there's a trick that I can do here to skip the cutscene where I learn the song. Like I said, cutscenes in this game need 2 frames to start, so if I can pause before the cutscene starts, I can soar away and it registers me as watching the cutscene, thus learning the song. Okay, there we go.
How much time does that save?
Around 30 seconds, maybe? It would say actually way more if you'd have to soar to a different place than Clocktown from here. A different place than Great Bay from here. Okay, here I'm gonna grab a 50 rupee chest to get some more money for more bomb juice later on. And after that we're gonna head off to Zora Hall and to Great Bay Temple. And similar to that, the cutscene skip I just did, I can actually skip the turtle cutscene that happens when I play the new wave button over here. But the pause is frame perfect, so I'll have to have good timing. Let's see. So, similar to that the first cutscene skip in the game, I can activate the cutscene by pausing just before it happens and go frame by frame into the loading zone of the Zora Hall. So when I exit this place, the turtle is there already, so I didn't have to watch the cutscene that happens afterwards. There's actually a trick that you can do to skip this cutscene right here, but even in real attempts, or like PB attempts, I haven't done it. It saves about 15 seconds, but it's kind of RNG dependent and hard to do. It's a very similar to the trick that I did to skip the first cutscene with the turtle. Alright, so we're tackling our first temple, and don't blink. Otherwise you're gonna miss it. So what I'm gonna do is grab this edge and drop a bomb in the corner. Then change the Zora and grab the edge again. And that bomb will push me out of bounds. From here I can angle myself correctly. I do a trick called recoil flip, where I shield the damage of the bomb and gain a lot of speed. And from there, I can hit the loading zone of the boss door, which is loaded even from the first room. So, that was Great Bear Temple.
I don't think anyone likes the temple anyway.
Yeah. Now, Great Bear Temple is actually great in speedruns that actually do it like glitchless or 100%. It's pretty fun. Even though I didn't like it casually either, but...
Yeah, I was gonna say, I don't think I've ever seen it in a speedrun before. I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, it's pretty intense. Alright, so here we have Gyor. This fight is pretty much done as normally. You can use the hookshot to stun him. And then with the Zora shield, you can actually stun him right after he's getting hit. So, you can do the first phase with one cycle. Same with the second cycle. And there's our first temple.
I'm actually a little bit surprised that the end of that boss fight doesn't set you in a position on the platform.
Yeah.
I've noticed a lot of others, all the bosses do that.
Yeah, yeah. That's one reason why the initial setups in OT for the wrong ropes work, because they actually set you in the same spot every time. So yeah, now we're going to learn the off-to-order, and this is another key item that we have to get in this run. You can actually skip all of the Giant's cutscenes, but you have to watch one in this run to learn the song. If you skip it, you won't actually learn the song. You're gonna see one of those cutscene skips soon when I go to Woodfall after this. All right, so Woodfall is our next destination, but before that, I want to make a quick stop at Clocktown to fill up on explosives. So by selecting Woodfall on the map screen, I can travel to Clocktown. Here again, selecting Mountain Village will take me to Woodfall. Yeah, as you can see, you make quite a few bomb shop trips in this run. Explosives are definitely the most used and useful item in MM speedruns. The bomb shop trips take a while though. There's an alternative harder route that you can do that actually skips that bomb shop trip right there, but I figured it would be kind of unsafe for the marathon. Which is ironic because I failed the easier gravel warp. Had to do the backup anyway. But that's alright. So we're playing the Sonata of Awakening to raise the temple, and this temple's loading zone actually exists beneath the ground, but sadly there's no way to reach it as for now. So you have to get the song.
Noticing a trend here of loading zones that aren't accessible until you hit certain requirements or certain flags.
Yeah. So it would fall. Having the hookshot in here helps a little. There's a couple of torches you can hit with it. And we're heading to the bull fight. And one special property that the Japanese version has is a technique called power crouch stabbing. And what that does, when I jump slashed there to get up the ledge, it actually stored the jump slash damage in my crouch stab. So every time I crouch stab there, it did a full damage of a jump slash. Or did I even fail that jump? Oh well, I can just hookshot back up from here. Have to end turn, re-enter this door to set my respawn position. What I want to do from here is to go out of bounds through this corner. Whoops. And do Ocarina dive. And do the same kind of glitch I did at the beginning of a run to store Song of Double Time. But this time I'm gonna store Song of Time. And that has the same kind of a property. I can bring it up by reading a text box, which is gonna be really useful in the old overfall boss fight. And from here, from this out of bounds spot, I can hover around the pre-boss door. And I can hit the loading zone of the boss door and end up here. So here I'm gonna read this description of the Ocarina. And that text box is the Song of Time's text box. Do I want to save and return to the dawn of the first day? So if I bring it up before I kill the boss, I can move around while this text box is up. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna head over here, pick up the remains, save and reset. And what that does, it actually plays the remains in my inventory, but I won't have to watch the Giants cutscene afterwards. Yeah, this is the reason why the any percent run has so many cycles, because resetting is actually useful. So, another day and another temple. Next, I want to head to Snowhead, but before that, I'm gonna buy, guess what? More explosives. So, gotta get this rupee chest here.
A little easier to get to with the Zora.
Yeah, you can do a gainer there. As Zora, but not as human. Zora Link is a little bit higher, taller than human Link, so you will have to go around as you would as human. Alright, so I need 10 bombs, 20 bomb chips, but I only have 99 rupees. But after buying bombs, if I mash fast enough, I fail it, but you can actually buy two sets of bomb chews with 67 rupees. That's okay, I'll just have to collect a few rupees before continuing onward.
I never knew there was rupees in there.
Yeah, me neither before started through speed runs. Ah. Hitting the bushes with Zora is kinda hard. One drop. Lucky that I got bombs, though. That's good. So yeah, after that I want to head to the Snowhead area, but again, we're taking a bit unusual route there. So, I'm heading to Woodfall, and more specifically, the Fairy Fountain in this area. And the Fairy Fountains are done the same as the Grottos in this game, so all of the five Fairy Fountains exist on the same map. So, I can do a similar thing that I tried to do with the Grottos, that I can hover out of bounds here and then travel to another Fairy Fountain. Okay, so now I'm in the Snowhead Fairy Fountain, and I can exit the Fairy Fountain and end up here. But the thing is, the Goron is still trying to blow me away from here. But with the Infinite Sword glitch, I can actually stay on the edge, even though he's blowing. A property in this game is that whenever you swing your sword, the game won't let you fall. So, when I have the Infinite Sword glitch active, my sword hitbox is always active. So what I can do is that I can stay on the edge because my sword is swimming all the time. Oh, that was too late. Please make it okay. So from here, I couldn't just walk up to this point, but if I do a super slide and have good luck so the wind won't blow me away, I can travel behind the... What? I can travel behind the Snowhead Tower.
I find it interesting the wind goes across the entire map and not just in the, like, out and from in front of the Goron.
Yeah, yeah. Even though the Goron's sitting, or I'm sitting in front of me, the wind still is effective throughout the whole area. So, this trick skipped the Goron lullaby and getting Goron mask completely. Okay, here I'm gonna attempt a trick called Axis Swap. Okay, got it. Hopefully I get the arrows. Good. So, what I did, I had the hookshot in hand and pressed the deco stick button right before that text box appeared. So what that does, I can shoot a lit arrow without ever having the fire arrows. And here I can do a kind of a precise hookshot to get on top. Good. Normally you would supposed to spawn a scarecrow there, and first hookshot to the scarecrow and then to that torch, but with precise positioning you can do that without even getting the scarecrow. And some long jumps to do long jumps to get over here. Here's the wish rope fight. I jump slashed with the deco stick. Restore it to my crouch stab. And that actually does more damage than jump slashing with the Kokiri sword. So that wooden stick is more powerful than our actual sword. And with the infinite sword glitch, there was supposed to be a second phase, and before that a cutscene, but if you have the infinite sword glitch active, or you do a frame perfect stab on the guy, you can actually kill him without ever activating the cutscene. So now, proceeding further into the temple. Whoa. That's not supposed to happen. That's okay. Usually I don't get that kind of angle where I... after jumping first, then jump right after, but... can sometimes happen, I guess. So, to get furthermore up, we're gonna do some more hovers. Jolly will set up to blow up all the three snowballs with one bomb chew. And once we're up, we're gonna go down. And this is to store some of time once again to do a cutscene skip at the end of the fight. So with IC active, I can clip out of bounds through that torch and then stop the hover or stop my fall with a bomb chew, and then from there I can Ocarina dive. Then Frosted Scap with Hovers. And with the same trick I did in Great Bay Temple, I can do a recall play but gain a lot of speed through this corner. Maybe. Okay, to get out of bounds and skip the boss key very easily.
I think this is my favorite boss in the run. I just like the setup for it.
Yeah. Compared to what people usually did that casually, it's really, really fast. So for the golf fight, what we are gonna do is that golf will run around the corner and stay there for a while. So what we are gonna do is... Hit him. Oh, that's kind of bad. He isn't supposed to keep attacking. Ah, well. I'm just gonna wait until he runs around. So what was supposed to happen? He stays there for a set time. And by showing myself to him for a little while, I can reset that timer. And if I did that fight perfectly, the last shot that I shot with my arrow, the moment I shot my arrow, he would have run towards me and ended up here on the last shot. But that's fine too. Oh, Wesley, there. So here, the same thing. As I pick up the remains, I'm gonna save my game and reset my console to skip the cutscene. So, we have one temple left. And this stone tower. And to get there, I can now again use the properties of the hidden owl to soar straight to stone tower. So, by selecting Goron Village, the hidden owl will actually point towards the stone tower owl. Thus, I don't have to get the mirror shield or the Elegy of Emptiness at all. Here I want to catch this fairy, and with this fairy I'm gonna do a similar trick that I did to skip a cutscene earlier in the run with the time stop glitch. So, by first pressing shield and then bottle right after, if that's the right order, if I remember it right, I can enter time stop and cutscenes don't activate during that mode. So I can walk away from the block switch onto the block and then cancel the time stop, and the block will take me straight to the temple. From here I want to enter to this door right here and drop a bomb at a very specific spot. If I did this right, after the bomb explodes I should clip through this corner here. Yep. With enough speed, you can clip through that corner in many various ways. Over here to get a small key, and this is actually the only small key we get in this run. And in this next room, I'm gonna do a trick that allows me to hookshot underground. And how that's done is similar to the Hess glitch. By rolling into the bomb, I can gain a lot of speed, and at some point it starts to break Link's model. So if I input the hookshot at the right time, I can actually make Link's camera fall under the ground. And from there I can use the hookshot to hookshot through objects. Well, not through objects, but objects under the ground. Alright, so here we have the Garrow Master. And the fire arrows I got from Snowhead are a pretty good way to fight him. And here I want to take damage because I want to do a death war right after this. And depending if I time this right, opening the chest right, I can get either a fast death warp or a slow death warp, and looks like I was a bit too early, but that's okay. So I want to go to the entrance again to invert the temple. And dying here is actually a little bit faster than using Song of Soaring to get to the temple entrance. So here I can use the same trick, the weird shot, to shoot this switch under the ground. I keep going a frame early. Okay. It's kind of a precise trick. Here I want to store some time for another cutscene skip. I only have two bombs, so I have to do some alternative strats, but that's okay. So, in inverted stone tower, I want to enter this room right here. Get a specific angle and jump over here. Turn around and jump slash. And this should give me a recoil off that ledge. Yeah. That's a neat way to get over here. Normally you're supposed to get a small crew from pressing that switch, but by doing a recoil flip you can go over here straight away. Here I'm gonna do another weird shot. Ah, again, frame early. That's okay, I can go to the bottom part by the intended way. From over here, there's a couple of bomb drops and arrow drops and magic drops that I want to pick up. And from here, I can do another Busky skip. And how that this works, I'm gonna slash my sword three times to go to a very specific spot. And by doing a recoil flip, I can clip through a little seam beside the door. With a high enough velocity, you will just clip through into the bus door.
Walls don't exist if you believe hard enough.
What?
I said walls don't exist if you believe hard enough.
Yep. Anything is possible. Alright, so here we have Twinwald, which is arguably the hardest boss fight in this game. Since we don't have the Giant's Mask, we're gonna use fire arrows and light arrows to kill Twinwald. that requires some kind of a precise shots. So, how this fight works is that the blue one is weak to fire and the red one is weak to ice. But I only have fire arrows and light arrows. And the light arrow is kind of in the middle there. It does more damage than normal arrows, but less than fire arrows to the blue one. So how I like to count them is normal arrow does 1 damage, fire arrow does 3 damage, and light arrow does 2 damage. Ah, I shouldn't go on for that. That was too late anyway. So that's 6. Seven. 8. 9. Hopefully, yeah. And there I used Tattle's advice to bring up the Sanctan textbox. Oh, come on now. Okay. And since you actually can't play some time after you beat the boss, you have to activate the text before you beat the boss, otherwise this won't work. So here, the same thing. Pick up the remains, save the game, reset. And we're ready to go to the moon. But first, we're gonna do a few things to get there. Since it's the day of the first day, the clock tower door isn't open. So we need some way to get in there. And the easiest way to there, or the fastest way, is to hover. But instead of going to the bomb shop, we're gonna head out to Terminal Field to try for an RNG drop in the bushes. And also, there's a Dekubaba here that I can get a stick from. And since stick is powerful than my sword, it's gonna be really useful in the Majora fight. This is a pretty RNG heavy part of the run right at the end. You can lose a lot of time to this if you have bad luck, and I've seen many runs die to this. I think in my PB I lost 30 seconds to this. 2 drops, oh my god. That was okay. Second patch is okay, but if you don't get bombs on the second patch, then it starts to lose a lot of time. Okay. So, how we are gonna get into Clock Tower is to help with this dog. Gonna get the ISG off of him, dropping there. And if I target the dog, that'll actually unlock my camera. So, by doing that, I can actually turn around during the hover, which I normally wouldn't be able to do. You can do the same thing with bomb juice, and I actually forgot to explain that when I was doing the Woodfall boss key skip, so...
That's I'm so glad there's a skip that involves that dog.
Yeah, he's useful. He's a cool guy. What? Accidentally press B. Sometimes you have to be really careful not to play Song of Time here. If you haven't finished a run for a while.
That'd be kind of rough.
Yeah. Yeah.
So at this point, the bottleneck for 80% is the fact that you still have to collect all four remains?
Yeah, pretty much. But that makes the run interesting, in my opinion. Like, if it was just first cycle and then doing some huge trick to get that at the end of the game, that would be kind of bad. But then again, you would have the old dungeons category for preserving the same run, so... I think 80% still is a great speed run, but running it for a long time can be really tiring because of all of the resets and that 20-minute intro. This one would have been alright if I didn't fail the grotto at the beginning. I'm kind of sad about that, but it's okay, it's okay. Had to improvise a little bit, but we made it.
Everything else seemed pretty good.
Yeah.
Can't help but think that they stopped the moon and they're stuck there, and then now they're just standing there like, now what? Do we just stay here? I think a big thing for me with speedruns and wanting to do something over and over again is having a good soundtrack, and I love the soundtrack for this game.
Yeah, me too. And this cutscene as a whole.
I feel like there's a meme I don't know about. How dense is that moon?
I have no idea either.
Yes.
Sally. Alright, so gonna super slide over to Majora. And start the fight. Useful items for this fight are Deku Sticks, Riot Arrows, and the Zoro Mask. So, for the first phase, what I'm gonna do is stun him with Zorofens, and shoot him with light arrows. I repeat.
Is this first phase pretty consistent?
Yeah, the first phase is. The second phase is the most RNG dependent. And for the last phase, I'm just gonna jump flash since he has so little health. Okay, the second phase is a bit more random. I'm gonna try to stun him right away as he runs, maybe runs by me with the Zora armor. And if you manage to get that, it saves quite a bit of time. This guy is sometimes really this guy is sometimes really hard to hit. Okay, he didn't run to it. Okay. Okay, that was good. So there I stored the jump slash damage of the Deku Stick into my power grab stab. Damn it. Oh god, I'm gonna die soon. Also, the remains, how they shoot at you, it is random as well. Sometimes you can get many hits from them and can't do much about it. So it's a good idea to have a fair there. But sometimes you can't if you manage to pick up a Dekuna drop to erase that bottle. Luckily, I had one. Alright, get ready on time. Time. Ah, no. The classic. Classic happen. Okay, time.
Yo, 0 seconds.
World record. Did I go overestimate? Ah, the first run, I think. Ah, that's okay. Thank you for having me. And next up, we have Slucky doing some Bomberman 64.
Ironically, more fun with bombs.
Yep.